Data privacy has often been an afterthought in software and platform development. Data breaches have increased consumer awareness, and laws such as GDPR and CCPA have been enacted. Programmers and engineers need to think about what data they are collecting, how it's being stored and accessed, and how it's shared to protect their end users. Today's guest is Nishant Bhajaria. Nishant leads the technical privacy and strategy teams for Uber that include data scientists, engineers, privacy experts, and others as they seek to improve data privacy for the consumers and the company. Previously, he worked in compliance, data protection, security, and privacy at Google. He was also the head of privacy engineering at Netflix. He is a well-known expert in the field of data privacy, has developed numerous courses on the topic, and has spoken extensively at conferences and on podcasts. I'm your host, Chris Parker, and this is the Easy Prey Podcast. Nishant, thank you for coming on the Easy Prey Podcast today.
Thank you.
So can you give us a little background about how you were involved in privacy?
Thank you. Yeah. So I've been in this domain for a while now, and I started out my career as an engineer at Intel back in the day. I wrote code at WebMD. And then as the beginning of the 2010s really took hold, you had this move towards data-driven innovation where companies connected with the customers much more directly. The data collection from the customers enabled companies to understand the customers better. And we were in this sweet spot where Google and Facebook IPO'd, so that meant more data was gushing in. So eventually, as that moved forward, we were in this moment of reconciliation where there needed to be a balance between how much data are we collecting and how do you make sure that the customers are getting something for it? How do you make sure that the companies collecting the data are being careful custodians of customer data? And it was during this time that I was also working on the identity space. That is, how do you make it easier for customers to log into your platform? And that opened the door in the early 2010s to get into privacy. And I got to work with some really smart folks during my Nike days in Oregon, where to have a company of that scale, to have a company with that much of a brand reputation at stake, also in the global pantheon in terms of selling merchandise to folks. So it's a very customer-driven retail PR company all at once. That's how I got into privacy. So I had the product background, the engineering background, and just my debating background, my ability to write stuff meant that for a discipline that is by its inherent nature so cross-functional, so persuasive, so given to technology, and a hybrid role, if you will, that's kind of how I got into privacy. There was no one role that I applied for. Like, there wasn't a LinkedIn post or a Monster post. It was a series of conversations, a series of micro decisions. And then, of course, privacy became this cool thing to be in. So I was in privacy before it was cool, and then it became cool. So that's kind of the TLDR.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely a lot going on in privacy, particularly in the last couple of years with GDPR coming to fruition. I think a lot of us thought, is it really ever going to actually happen? That, you know, there's this objective, but is it actually going to end up happening? And actually, I'll give you an opportunity. Can you explain to the audience what GDPR is and CCPA? Yeah. Because those are kind of the two big ones to me.
Correct. Absolutely. And before I answer, I will stipulate that I'm not an attorney, so nothing I say here should be construed as legal opinion. So attorneys don't like it when engineers offer legal advice any more than engineers like it when attorneys offer technical guidance. So it's helpful to have that little demarcation. But the two laws that you mentioned are very, very germane, because all of us have gotten emails. My mom kept asking me why she keeps getting emails about GDPR. So there was, as I mentioned before, there has been this gradual ramp towards this moment where how do you ensure that customers have rights to their data, rights to what gets collected, how it gets used, how often it's collected, how long it's kept for, who it's shared with, who accesses it. So there's a lot of granular actions that happen when it comes to data collection. And the GDPR was essentially Europe's contribution to that, basically saying that let's give customers some very clear enumerated rights so that they can access their data and they can have a level playing field with companies that do the data collection. So phrases like right to be forgotten often come to mind, where customers are given a right to say, okay, company A, you collected all this data from me, give me the data you have, or delete all my data, forget me essentially. And of course, there's caveats to all of these. Like, nobody can be absolutely forgotten. There's reasons why you might want to keep that data in case they come back as a customer, in case there's a lawsuit, things like that. But for the first time, you had customers get very direct rights vis-a-vis companies in terms of data collection. CCPA is essentially the California response to that. And I like to say the U.S. response, because unlike GDPR, the U.S. does not have a federal national privacy law. That might change. As of this recording, we are literally 2 days away from a new administration, a new DOJ taking office in D.C. So that might change by the time the audience hears this, although I'm not sure a new privacy law is going to be foremost in the minds of President Biden when he comes in. But CCPA essentially is significant because California is one of the world's largest economies. Depending on how you count, it's either the fifth or the sixth or the seventh largest economy in the world. So it sets the tone for what counts as privacy law. So in terms of what companies are supposed to do with privacy before a product ships, so privacy impact assessments, which basically is a fancy way of saying that before you ship a product out, a company has to do some sort of checks to make sure that there won't be privacy harms. How do you make sure the data is deleted in time? How do you make sure that customers have to consent before you collect their data or track them across different websites? In fact, it's important that you mention CCPA, because the phrase consent is going to be a big topic in 2021. Apple is going to essentially mandate that app developers collect consent much more explicitly from users before their data is collected. So you can draw a straight line between decisions we made back in the early 2010s in terms of data collection, the significant growth companies had in terms of understanding their customers and being able to monetize their data, some of the problems this industry has had in terms of companies and how they've misused data and made mistakes, governments and their misuse of data, GDPR, CCPA, and Apple's moves on the consent side, and what Google's going to do with the Chrome privacy sandbox. So all of these are fairly interdependent events over the span of a decade.
And they're all kind of hopefully leading to a same consistent common goal, although they're not coordinated in that sense.
Correct. And you made a great point, a common goal and not coordinated. They have a common goal in terms of protecting customers and ensuring that companies are diligent, ethical players with customer data. The challenge is that all of these laws and all of these regulations are often written by folks that may not have domain expertise on the technology side. Like, they may not be data scientists. They may not know the difference between protecting data in an unstructured database like Cassandra versus what happens at the back end in Hadoop, for example. They may not understand that deleting data often hurts the customer more than helps them, because, for example, if a customer gets upset at you as a company and deletes their data, but then they come back 2 days later because they've cooled down a bit, they want to be able to access their previous shopping history. They want to access their previous saved wish lists, for example, right? So there is context gaps here. And one of the opportunities of the moment and the perils of the moment is that if companies start doing the right thing from a privacy perspective from the get-go, at the same time, if governments write these laws in a way that represent some understanding of the technical choices at hand, we could collectively do a much better job of protecting the customers. And that is where the uncoordinated nature is challenging, because things are moving pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Because as an industry, as a country, as a society, we're making up for lost time. And sometimes that leads to suboptimal outcomes.
One of the kind of funny anecdotes I've thought about with respect to right to be forgotten is, if someone submits a request, I want you to delete all my data. Once you've deleted all the data, do you have an obligation to delete the request and the history of the request, because you're still retaining customer data if you retain the request?
Correct. Yeah, it's almost like the classic chicken and egg conundrum. Like, it's like everything we needed to know we learned in fifth grade, right? It's like this is that fifth grade question coming back right here. And this is where, you know, the laws tend not to be very prescriptive. They tend not to be very, very granular. And I give the regulators credit for that. They are trying to figure this out. Like, when people on the tech side in the Silicon Valley circles complain about regulation, I tell them, we didn't get here all of a sudden. We got here because of several mistakes that people made across the board. And this is true on all sides. And I feel like it's going to take some iterative processes to get this right. And it's easy to complain about some of this stuff, but the point you raise is a good one, which is, what does retention look like? And it's not just retention. That is, what do we retain? How long do we retain it for? How do we tie it to a specific use case, right? I'm not opposed to people collecting and retaining data. It's more about, what's going to happen to it? Are you retaining data because you think someday in the future you might find good use for it, and therefore let's keep it? I got a problem with that.
Yeah.
Because you've created a security attack vector, and also you haven't given the customer choice. At the same time, if you delete data too quickly to demonstrate that you are an ethical player, well, you've also created an incentive for somebody to do stuff with their data very, very quickly and then delete it quickly as well. So there's trade-offs here, right? And I think this is where having some of these controls built early in the pipeline, like I've talked about in the book that we're going to discuss, are critical simply because that way you've built some sort of a fail-safe, even if the law is not very clear.
So we're talking about kind of the evolution of the laws coming into fruition. Were there, in your mind, certain triggers that ultimately caused the legislation? Was there particular data breaches? Were there particular behaviors associated with data like Facebook and Cambridge Analytica? Yeah. Or were there other kind of industry things that you see as, well, these are definitely catalysts that made GDPR and CCPA, you know, kind of brought it to the front of mind and caused the legislatures to, hey, we need to do something?
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, you mentioned the Facebook issue with Cambridge, and it's interesting that happened in 2018, but some of those decisions, some of the fixes were already in place by the time that issue came to light. And GDPR was already in the works at that moment, right? So people often think of coinciding events and associate causality to it, and that I don't think the case here. I think what brought us to this moment is strategically this realization that fundamentally the United States has a very different understanding of privacy holistically as a concept, as a construct, and as a gesture than some of our more European partners in this industry. And I'm often on these panels where the biggest disagreements and contextual gaps tend not to be between the engineers and the attorneys, but they tend to be between US counsel and EU counsel in terms of the granularity, the understanding, the detailed structured nature of privacy obligations, et cetera. So for a long time, we have always believed that on the American side, that the more data we have, the better it is for everyone. The customers don't need to make too many granular choices. They don't have as many toggles. Like, can you imagine if you had to answer 15 different questions before a website actually materialized for you? Like, people get upset on the phone when they have to validate themselves with their bank.
Yeah.
I'm like, what are you expecting? Like, you just want to get into your account so somebody else can get a ton of money from you, right? So those security measures exist for a reason, but people also are extremely impatient. So this is not just about the companies. So what this enables us to do is a sense where you can give customers some choice and at the same time enable business to be more agile as well. So we were getting to that moment for a long time. How do you make sure that the customers have a clear view of their data? How do you make sure that companies have governance in terms of data collection before something bad happens? Because everybody worth their salt tends to have a decent incident response team. Like, nobody wants to be the person that doesn't know how to respond when something bad happens.
Yeah.
It's what you do before that determines this stuff, right? Because as an example, let's assume you make a stupid privacy decision and data ends up in the hands of the wrong third-party vendor, right? Well, you go back to, should that data have been collected? Should that data have been logged? Should that data have been captured by some other database? Should a query have been able to access that data? Should some API have been able to send that data externally to the company? Should we have had a rate limit to that API, right? There's a bunch of micro decisions that get made before something bad happens, right? So GDPR was about saying you need to have some sort of governance structure, right? And that was not waiting for some breach or some privacy incident someplace else. It just so happens from a calendar perspective that in May 2018, GDPR became the law of the land, so to speak. At the same time, we had the congressional testimony that I think you're alluding to right now. But I feel like GDPR and the motion towards privacy regulation was in place well before that.
Yeah, that was kind of my perception. But I think in you know, public's eye, they don't until, you know, GDPR what had a 2-year ramp in, if I remember right. You know, people didn't hear about GDPR until websites started popping up.
Yes.
Cookie consent forms to say, do you really want to do this? Or if you were outside of the U.S., well, there were some websites that just started blocking EU visitors entirely because they didn't want to deal with trying to identify how do we deal with consent and how do we deal with data. It was just easier to say, we don't want you as a customer. We don't even want you touching our website.
Yeah. And I feel this is where sometimes these laws can be counterproductive if you aren't prepared for them, simply because a lot of these small companies, they just don't know what to do. And I feel like if you have enough of a privacy protection posture within your enterprise, it becomes easier to relate to the customers in a way where you can say, yes, we are okay from a legal perspective as well. If your attorneys sign off on that. Let me give you an example. You gave a very good example of companies blocking out EU users. I used to go to a gym 3 years ago. And what happened right about the time GDPR was passed was, until then, I would sign into the kiosk at the front door. I would get my badge in. And essentially, all I then had to do was get to the treadmill or the elliptical and enter my code. And they would lock me in, and all my previous workout histories, my previously saved workouts, they would all be there. And I didn't have to reconfigure anything. I would just say workout number one, I would run for 60 minutes. Off to the races I go. After GDPR, I'm not sure how that decision was made, but I had to sign in with my badge at the kiosk up front. And then I had to re-sign in to the treadmill, which meant I had to enter my username and my password. And I didn't know this was going to happen. So I picked my first name and my last name concatenated as my username, which if you know my name, it's not easy to enter in the morning when it's cold. So the customer friendliness aspect fell by the wayside because the gym was taking a very conservative route to GDPR. My hope is that 3 years in, there is enough understanding, enough universality, enough application, and thankfully companies have matured enough to the point where we can have some consistency in terms of what we do in a given situation.
Gotcha. So were there, were there like mistakes, some big mistakes that companies have made that have kind of formed decisions on here's how we need to start designing privacy? I mean, like it used to be, you and I have been in IT long enough that we're back in the days where, you know, the internet was not built with security in mind. It was built with everybody trusts, all connectivity is trusted. And then at some point we realized, oh, there's bad players. We need to design in security. And so security was not initially by design. And I think we got better about having security by design. Is it sort of the same thing going on with privacy, that there's these big mistakes that have happened that have like, ooh, we need to watch out because of that?
Absolutely. Yeah. So one of the changes that took place in the early 2010s was this access revolution. To your point, all connectivity is good was the phrase you used. One of the paradigms when I was a programmer at Intel was if I needed access to anything, I had to figure out how to get access to it. Like it was not granted by definition. I had to make a business case for it. I had to enter multiple passwords to get access to what was known as Intel's Red Cookbook, which was the formulas that Intel used to build out its test chip. And I was one of the engineers on the advanced design team, and I had access, and I still had to get in, budget 10 minutes to get in properly. Fast forward 5-6 years, all access was open. You know, anybody could spin up an S3 bucket, not at Intel, at other companies. You could spin up an S3 bucket, put data there. You could have an API and ingest data. You could create copies of data. And the goal was to ensure fast movement. This is when we also moved from the structured key value pair databases to the unstructured JSON blobs in Cassandra and MongoDB, which meant that customers wanted access to data quick, to the app quickly, which means engineers wanted access to operational data quickly, which meant that the data scientists at the back end wanted access to queries quickly, which meant they could understand exactly what to do next for the customer. Velocity and throughput became the lay of the land, which meant that let's not gate any access. Let's build whales, not walls, was sort of the phrase people used back in the day. So to your point, what meant was some people got access that they shouldn't have gotten. And of course, any mistake that you look at in Silicon Valley in terms of companies, including some that I may have worked for, come back to the fact that either too much was collected or too much was accessible. And you want to figure out a way where you manage access that respects people's legitimate need for access, where the customer and the engineer both benefit. But at the same time, there is some sort of accountability to the access where you can gate access if required, and you can audit access once access was granted. So in case somebody behaved badly, you can understand what was done, why it was done, and you can understand why it was done, and you can make sure that it doesn't happen again. So that pivot was a painful one because a lot of engineers got used to this idea that it's always going to be this way. A lot of these engineers, you got to remember, they joined the workforce after 2009, 2010. So Lehman Brothers fell, the economy contracted, and then we had this data revolution where a lot of folks joined the workforce understanding that stock prices always go up, data always comes in, access is always granted. And then these qualifiers for security and privacy came much afterwards. So we're talking about a societal, a systemic change, and the technical controls we're building are meant to essentially remedy some of those misconceptions that simply don't scale anymore. We simply cannot live in a world where everybody can access whatever data they want to, no questions asked. That doesn't work ethically. It doesn't work technically. It doesn't work scalably. It doesn't work for security. It doesn't work for privacy.
Do you think this also some reasons that this total access to data was just a matter of, well, it's just easier? I don't want to have to think about all building access control lists. I don't want to have to think about the business cases. Let's just, they're a vendor. We trust them. Let's just give them access to whatever they need so they can get the project done for us.
Yeah, it was. I think it was the Silicon Valley version or the tech version of the go-go 80s. I'm not going to use the Michael Douglas quote from Wall Street because it would be too on the nose. But yeah, some of it was about just good faith. Every engineer, including when I wrote code back in the day, believed that they are always ethical. It's always the other folks out there. They're the bad ones, right?
Yeah.
And the problem is, it's not my malintent that makes me dangerous. It's my clumsiness. It's my forgetfulness. It's my carelessness where I create this data store someplace. I write this API. I make it available to everyone. And somebody else is going to use it for some purpose other than the one I wrote it for. That's the risk vector. So there was that. There was also this phenomenon where people just didn't know what this data meant. Like, essentially, there are research studies out there that show that a combination of your online data makes you a lot more accessible than even your fingerprint. Like, when I became a US citizen, I had to give 10 sets of fingerprints to the US government before they'd let me become a citizen. You don't need anything nearing that to identify me with my online data.
Yeah.
Like Senator Romney from Utah was identified. He has a Twitter account called Pierre Delecto. He used that account to make interesting comments that he wouldn't make as a U.S. senator. And a journalist was able to identify that data within like a couple of hours, just based on who was following him, who he was following, etc. So when you have this preponderance of data available, people didn't foresee how identifiable that can make somebody just based on easy access to the data. And privacy is all about, don't identify me, don't track me unless I give you consent. Well, if my data is already out there, the cat's out of the bag.
Yeah.
So people just didn't foresee the potency of unmitigated access as well as the danger of combinations of data that are out there.
Yeah, I remember reading a study that some college had put together, someone had put together, where they were able to look at who you're connected to on Facebook with reasonably publicly available data, and be able to figure out your gender preference based on who you knew and who they knew. So they were like, oh, well, we know, you know, the gender preferences of these people, even if they haven't publicly discussed it.
Yeah.
And so it was like, oh, gee, like, we don't realize how easy we don't. I think in general, we don't understand the implications of our own data. We, even as consumers, we think, oh, well, that's a trivial piece of information that can't be used for anything, but in combination with a bunch of other things or a few other things, it can.
Yeah. And, you know, when we disperse our data, when we vend our data as customers, we think of the most imminent use case, like getting access to something or getting that free subscription or getting that gift card. It's very, very similar to the student union building on graduation day when people were signing up for those credit cards to get that free pizza, right? There's no pizza anymore. There's just the pie of tools and apps that people have online. And we're, unfortunately, customers are still signing up for that stuff. And you know, I want to be very careful here. I don't want it to seem like I'm blaming these customers because we have built the internet based on fast movement.
Yeah.
I have a fast app. I have a fast need. You know, when the pandemic hits, I want to be able to get my groceries without going into a grocery store. We are expecting as customers, the market to adapt to our needs. The market expects customers to remember what they signed up for. These are incompatible requirements. Like, customers don't have the time to understand these details, but at the same time, application developers also have families to feed. They also have the need to build out apps. They compete in a very, very high visibility, high touch point marketplace, right? So I feel like, yes, everybody's made mistakes in the past. And I think the only way we're going to get to a better place from a privacy perspective is keep building out the tooling, keep building out the connecting tissue between different teams that tend to be very siloed, that we should talk more about how companies actually build these tools, and essentially making sure that there is this heady exchange of ideas between the regulators on the one side and the innovators on the other side. Because otherwise, we're going to have this phenomenon of talking past each other where we will have a ton of laws, a ton of tools, but the customers are no better for it, which I want to really avoid here.
So to bring this down to things that, let's say, we're not an engineer at Google or a Fortune 500 company. We're an engineer for a mom and pop company that's got 20, 30, 50 employees, and we're building out some web applications or websites, and we have data coming in and data going out. What are some of the gotchas where people make mistakes? You talked about the carelessness and the clumsiness. What are some of the things that, like, you know, if all you get out of this episode and you're an engineer, is you need to look for these couple of things.
Yeah.
Not to say that those are the end all be all, but correct. Like, what are the most common things that you've seen in your experience?
Yeah.
Where people are missing the mark.
Perfect. Now, I think I can narrow it down to like the top three things you should definitely do if you're a small company. And I think particularly companies that are small that don't have the headcount, the big legal teams to essentially deal with the privacy issue were it to happen, that's who would really benefit from the context we're talking about here. So, Chris, the first instance is make sure that you know what you're collecting. So think of data collection as being this horizontal funnel. Like the narrow end on the left-hand side and the end on the right-hand side is much bigger. It gets broader. The data you collect grows once it enters your system, right? People make copies of it. People infer things from that data, like the point you made about being able to understand who somebody is based on a bit of data that they have given you. So the size and scale of data grows once it enters your system. So understand at a very early point what you have. Try and build in technical controls to detect, am I collecting SSNs, for example? Am I collecting IP addresses? It doesn't take a whole lot of work to do it at that early stage because the volume of data is much more manageable. And based on that, you can build an understanding of who's collecting what data. Where is that data going to go? Who's going to access it? What use is it being put to? Most companies tend to do this at the back end of the process when data is at rest. The problem is at that point, the volume of data has grown, as has the usage, which means your ability to manage the outcomes and control the damage is much more limited. So try and catalog your data early in the process. It's like, you know, you make plans for your day first thing in the morning, right? You don't go on an hour-by-hour basis. At least I don't. Yeah. Most organized people don't. Treat your data the same way, treat your customers' data, rather, the same way you treat your time with respect. That's number one. The second thing is lean on tooling to build privacy at scale. So for example, the mistake these small companies often make, and I've made that mistake back in the day as well, which is they assume that if they teach these engineers how to do privacy right, different engineers will just do it right. Mm-hmm. The problem is your engineers are not bad people, by the way. I want to speak up for them because I used to be one of them. So a little biased here. But they are extremely busy. They have to ship products. They have these aggressive timelines, these Gantt charts, these OKRs, these company mission statements, the growth targets they have to meet. And when they have to make a critical choice between checking for privacy one last time or shipping that one extra feature, an engineer who has student loans to pay or a promo target to meet, they will always make one choice. So maybe not always, but most times. So it behooves you to build some central tools that multiple engineers can use at the same time. So rather than having 15 different engineering teams delete data on their own, maybe build a central data collection, data deletion service via API that these teams can use and delete their data for them. And they can choose. In some cases, you can delete the data altogether. In some cases, you can delink sensitive data from aggregated non-sensitive data. In some cases, you can obfuscate the data and make it available on a case-by-case basis, but make it available for them. Mm-hmm. If they have to spend, say, 4 hours or 4 days to delete data versus use your API and get it done in 40 minutes, you've made that choice much easier for them. And they will do the right thing because you've made the right thing easier for them. So that's number two. The third thing is make sure that this wall that often exists between the legal team and the engineering privacy team is broken down. So one of the things we've done very well at Uber here, and the legal partners on the other side deserve a ton of credit for this, is that we work in harmony. So if they intercept something that appears to have a privacy sensitivity to it, they pull us in, they pull my team in, and we help the engineers write better ERDs and PRDs, and we bake privacy into design. And then when the attorneys have to do a review at the tail end, they have the context because we prep them. And the engineering product that they're reviewing has the privacy controls baked in. Concurrently, if we see something that may not seem that great from an engineering perspective, but seems especially problematic from a legal perspective, we pull the attorneys in. And they provide us the cover that we need to make sure that our privacy controls are adopted. So make sure that the attorneys and the engineers on the privacy side actually work hand in hand. This is a very cross-functional endeavor, Chris. And I think this notion where you can stay in your silo and do things right from your perspective and everybody else can fend for themselves isn't going to work. Because somebody else's data collection could be your problem and your data might become somebody else's problem. So those are the three things that come to mind.
Yeah, I really like your point about the tools for deleting data, because I was thinking back of like, gosh, you know, with a lot of entities, what is collected kind of grows over time. That, oh, we've now added this new product, this new service, and we need to collect this additional data point. So now we've pulled it in. Well, if I was the engineer who designed something to delete data and that data point didn't exist before, it might not get deleted by my routine. Whereas if you've got, you know, one, this is the process to delete, and somebody owns that and everybody uses that, you're assured that, you know, it's getting everything and not just some things.
Exactly. And I think just to really double click on that, Chris, it's like when we talk to attorneys, and when I, not just at my company, but elsewhere, they want a level of certainty that there is consistency. Like if you have, I'm going to pick the example of a retail system, right? Let's assume you have a retail website, right? You have a service within the company that builds shopping carts. You have a website that takes care of the actual shipping of the products. You have another service that takes care of wish lists, right? And it all maps back to the same customer. If each of them have their own deletion service, deletion might be handled very, very inconsistently. And when an attorney comes and says, this customer has requested that their data be deleted, if there is inconsistency, you might end up with a situation where the attorney says, yes, we were done. And then you find out that one of those services didn't do deletion right, or they forgot to run their tool, or they forgot to check this other database. Versus if there is a centralized service, you can make sure that the service works the same way across all of the services and essentially deletes the same data, and you have a success or failure outcome that is much more manageable, right? You reduce this level of redundancy, you reduce this level of risk, because you basically have one service to fix at all times. So what people sometimes think is that having this central privacy team is going to be also expensive and it's going to cost money. And yes, it will in the beginning, mm-hmm. but over time, 3 or 4 or 5 months out, that's going to be much cheaper because you will prevent a bunch of bad stuff from happening. And if people often tell me privacy is expensive, I'm like, yeah, it is, but lack of privacy is much more so.
Yeah. A class action lawsuit is way more expensive than an engineer.
Yeah. And not just to mention, it's a reputational damage, right? It's the trust damage. There are some companies who are, because they are so entrenched in our lives, they may be able to get by and they may be able to fix these issues and come back from that. Like with Equifax, for example, they had this breach and I was impacted by the Equifax.
Who wasn't?
My wife wasn't, thank goodness.
Oh, that's good.
She reminds me how lucky she is compared to me. So the problem is, in Equifax's case, I have to use them. Like I don't apply for loans often, but if you apply for a loan, chances are Equifax will be part of the picture. Like I check my credit score every month on Credit Karma and they tell me what my Equifax score is. I don't have a choice to back out.
Yeah.
But if you're a new company, you're a Series A or a Series B company, what if the VC says, oh my goodness, this is just too risky, I'm going to back away? Like, do you want to be that entrepreneur right now? So those are some of the choices you want to ask yourself before making, right? These decisions you make today will come back and bite you at a later point. And on the other hand, you could do this thing from a privacy perspective that could be a great investment to make. If you delete data you don't need, if you obfuscate data that you don't need, if you delete duplicate copies of data, you have less data to store. That is less money paid to your cloud providers. It's an economical issue. You have an improved data quality picture, which means your queries won't take as long to run. Heaven forbid you get breached, the risk of you losing out on data has gone down significantly. Like if you have two copies of the same darn data, the potential of that breach impacting you is much higher. So there is a business reason to do the right thing as well. Like in politics, people often say good policy is good politics. My response to that is good privacy is good business.
Yeah. It's just for a lot of people, it's not, privacy was really not a thought. I mean, it wasn't part of design 10, 15 years ago. Maybe it was 10 years ago, but anyone who's building a product now, you better doggone be thinking about privacy.
Exactly. And I feel like the challenge for people like me is to make the case not just from an altruistic perspective. I think people often, if you make the right case, if you make the case purely from the perspective of do it because it's the right thing, people are like, okay, but I have these vast important business goals to meet. I feel the stronger business case, the more honest business case is to be made to the sense of how much money you can save, how many more customers you can add, how many more markets you can get into. There is a definitive strong link between business benefit and correct privacy posture. And I feel like that is where the industry needs to go next, where the closer you explain that link, the more success you're going to have in building a good program and also demonstrating that it's the right thing to do.
Gotcha. So from a consumer perspective, is there a way for us as consumers to kind of know, short of data breaches that are disclosed, you know, are there signs that companies are not handling our data well? Are there things that we should be watching out for? Things like, gosh, I'm just signing up for, you know, a company to ship me eggs and they want to know my social security number. I mean, something like that should be a red flag of like, well, yeah. Why do you need that piece of data? But what should consumers be thinking in when they're dealing with apps and websites in terms of their own privacy? What should they be watching out for?
Yeah, I think what you should be watching out for is precisely are the examples you mentioned, which is there a disconnect between the use case for data collection and the volume of data collector and the type of data collector. Like, why would you need an SSN for groceries? Like, you wouldn't. You also want to look at data collection and protection practices, right? If you can get any information about how exactly your data is being stored, how is it being collected, who has access to it, like those sorts of pieces of data can be very helpful. And I think companies tend to be very good about that stuff, especially when they're in the public eye, making sure that there are secure MTLS connections, making sure that any sorts of collection of data is protected very well behind firewalls, those sorts of things, making sure that there is obfuscation of data. One thing I also tend to do is, if I'm talking to venture capitalists, if I'm advising a company, I want to see, are they investing in their security team? Like, you can go on their LinkedIn profile and look at the number of employees they have and check, do they have investment in security and privacy? So what happens is, if companies invest in security and privacy after a ton of growth, you can almost be fairly certain that they're trying to bring in the security and privacy folks to clean up a mess that has been made during the growth phase. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, if they invest in this stuff at the early stage of their innovation, that means they're serious. So you want to check in that stuff as well. You want to check and see, how does the company's investment in security and privacy correspond to their growth stage? That's number three. And the other thing you want to check about is, like, who is the company doing business with? Like, are they sharing a whole bunch of data with third-party vendors? Like, I tend to look at those disclosures, and thankfully, because of some of the work Apple is doing in this space, companies are going to have to get out in front and say, here's what we are collecting your data for, give us consent. And I think that has been one of the benefits of GDPR and CCPA, where, in, albeit in somewhat of a clumsy fashion, companies are having to explain for the first time what they will do with the data, mm-hmm. right? That explanation is not very simple. It takes a long time. Like, heck, even our credit card statements tend to be very, very thick. I remember my first mortgage, it was like, 15, 20 pages long. But at least we're getting to a point where the two sides are talking to each other. So, but the biggest bit of advice I would give to customers is, ask questions. You know, read up on this stuff. Because mm-hmm. at the end of the day, it's your data. And I get that I've been working for Silicon Valley and tech companies for the last 15 years. But I also have an ethical obligation to make sure that I have a responsibility towards the customers as well, where I have to be the customer advocate within the company. Because for me to build my tools and to build tools that genuinely make a difference, I have to think about the customer behind the data. There's a human being, somebody who lives someplace, somebody who has kids, who has parents, who goes places, who eats stuff, who has an identity. Maybe they live in a country where their identity might get them killed. Maybe their identity, their activities might put them in jeopardy, right? So what we do with their data affects their well-being. So you want to look at how companies behave overall and then make a decision as well and hold companies to that standard. And also, me as an employee, I have to think about it through that veneer as well, and making sure that when I talk to internal engineers, product managers, remind them of that perspective. So that's kind of a long answer, but I just wanted to speak more as a human being in that perspective.
No, I appreciate that, and I like that. I haven't really started to look at Apple's privacy nutrition labels. Do you think that's going to be a big shift in what you see from app stores, that you'll start seeing the same sort of thing in the Google store, that here's what this app is doing, here's the data it is collecting, and here's what they're doing with it?
Yeah, so the phrase first mover advantage often gets used in the industry, and I think Apple has built a brand when it comes to privacy. And, you know, I have a lot of friends who work in the Apple privacy team, just like I have friends who work in pretty much every privacy team in the Valley, and they are among the smartest people I've known. Mm-hmm. And I believe so. And I think that they have put the marker on the ground, saying that, yes, we want there to be a more explicit consent model. And I think the paradigm that I'm not sure about how it develops, Chris, is that Apple serves a very, very specific kind of clientele, a very, very, you know, discernible clientele, people who pay a lot of money for their phones. So the argument goes that these folks are going to expect a lot more privacy because they are paying for it. Now, I have problems in a world where you make privacy a privilege for people that are affluent. But let's just go with the Apple model for the time being, where the expectation is that once Apple does it, one of the two main platforms does it, well, Google will follow. And then it becomes customer expectation. So I would say even money, yes, there's a very good chance that's the direction we go in. I think the opportunity here is, how do you make sure that the handshake is much more educational, where companies have a way to do this in a way that is not overly disruptive to the point where the experience becomes affected, where if you have this strong pop-up that doesn't let you go forward unless you check 15 boxes, I'm pretty sure a lot of app developers, video game developers will have a problem with that. How do you make sure that the experience has a UI customer-centric focus to it? Because the last thing you want on the other extreme is to make privacy this extreme esoteric blocker that's going to hurt small businesses where they can't get a hold of their customers anymore. Because the only people that will benefit are the really big companies that allegedly need to be held to a much higher standard, right? So getting that balance right is going to be critical. And I've talked to my friends across the valley, and we're all trying to figure out how this happens. And this is all happening during a very crazy time in our industry right now. Yeah. The world is not exactly settled. So I wish we were having this conversation in early 2020, late 2019, rather than during this time. But the cool thing, Chris, is that this is when innovation happens, right? Some of the smartest ideas come during times of unrest. So my hope is all this online data that we're generating, all this online commerce that is happening, will lead to a better, richer understanding of our sheer need for each other and a better solution for everyone.
Yeah. And then there's also the, like, you know, from my perspective, I run a website. Mm-hmm. I get lots of people coming to the site. Mm-hmm. I don't charge people for my website, but I still need to be able to make a living.
Yeah.
Then there's this balance of revenue with data that everybody has to work out, you know, that everyone has to kind of figure out on their own in terms of, like, you know, what do I need to, how much money does my app need to earn me for me to be able to continue to produce a good app? Do I charge for it, or do I do it with some sort of data sharing agreed upon with the user, or, you know, previously not agreed upon?
Definitely. And I think if I had my druthers, and this is something I always push my teams to do, which is, let's make the first offering. Like, let's not wait for an Apple or an FTC or the EU to come forward with something. Let's basically say, here's how we are doing it. Here's how we believe finds the right balance between data collection, monetization, personalization on the one side, and ethical privacy data management on the other. And let it be open for scrutiny. I mean, this is what engineers do when they open source their stuff, right? Mm-hmm. They open source it. It belongs to the community. The community then adopts it. It becomes something that is used significantly. Others improve it. So let's open source privacy. Let's do it that way. And let's make sure that the regulators, the legislators are part of the conversation. Because I'm fairly certain that at the end of the day, people who genuinely care about privacy in the US and elsewhere, they want to do this right as well. And they need the engineering support that is available in the industry right now.
Yeah. And to me, it's one of those things that I've always struggled with politicians creating laws to deal with tech when they don't understand the tech. But I think this is one of those issues where, like, we're talking about if the industry leads and says, hey, this is what we need to do to protect user privacy. Okay, legislatures, here's what to do. Here's what we need to protect, and here's how we need to protect it, as opposed to the lawyers the lawyers on the way down not knowing what it all means.
Yeah. It's like the iconic moment in 2018 in the podcast with in the congressional testimony with Mr. Zuckerberg was when somebody in the U.S. Senate asked him, how do you make money? Like, the question was, you offer Facebook for free, and he said, we run ads. And people thought that was funny, you know, and I'm like, that's not funny. The disconnect between the people who build such an incredible service at scale, and I use Facebook aggressively for animal rescue, and the only thing I care about at the time is engagement. I want to make sure that as many people as possible see this so we can get this dog out of this high-kill shelter. So from my perspective, it's an incredible service. On the other side, I also need the government to be engaged and write a law that can be meaningfully implemented. So this gap is not helpful. Yeah. So we need to narrow it somehow.
Have you found that same sort of gap even within organizations where if you're an engineer saying, oh my gosh, we need to do a better job with our privacy, how do I communicate with the C-level who's like, no, privacy is not important?
So I've yet to run into a C-level that'll say that privacy is not important. I think making sure that it contextually makes sense to them is a different challenge. So how do you come up with metrics? So how do you assess what you will review? How do you make sure that you quantify risk? So how do you multiply the likelihood and the impact of risk? And how do you demonstrate that what you're doing has moved the needle? How do you demonstrate coverage of your privacy tools? That is, how many services have onboarded our services that we build for deletion, for export, for preservation? My teams actually build those services. And it's easy for me to demonstrate these many teams across the company have onboarded them. These other teams have not. Hey, SVP, can you please help your teams create prioritization for it? So that's how you do it. One thing we also do on my side here at Uber in partnership with legal is we write privacy policies and governance requirements within the company that are written in partnership with engineering. For example, what tools can we use for third-party data sharing? That enables us to onboard the right tools for third-party vendor data sharing. So as an example, if I'm sharing data with a third-party entity that does not have an SFTP server, we can put it on a cloud provider that has the appropriate security protections. That means we're buying that tool for the right reason. Mm-hmm. We have a reason to put the data in there. It's quantifiable. It's auditable. We can set up a password-protected link. We can delete the file once the access is complete. We can audit that the access was in fact correctly done. That goes into our third-party audits. That means we can demonstrate compliance. That means we can get into a specific market. I can tell that story to the board all day long because it has the benefit of preventing a privacy and security risk, also as a business benefit as well. So getting that context on a two-slide deck is the real challenge because there's a lot to do here. And how do you pick your targets? So my challenge is not shortage of challenges. My challenge is shortage of time. So,
yeah, that's good. So can you tell me more about your book and why you wrote it?
So I started writing this book because the challenge you mentioned, which
So what's the name of the book?
Oh, sorry, I kind of jumped. So the book is named Privacy by Design, and it's aimed towards engineers and technical program managers and senior architects in small businesses that are maybe 30 to 50 people large that need privacy guidance on how they implement privacy in their company. How do you make sure that you do privacy right from the get-go? How do you make sure that you are doing it right from the beginning so that you don't have to clean up all this debt at the back end? My recommendation also is to have CEOs, people in the media, people like yourself, industry influencers, people who deal with data collection, data monetization, people who deal with regulation, people who deal with government, read this book as well, because it will give you a sense of what it is like to implement these privacy controls. It is entirely possible that you understand only 30% of what it means to anonymize data. It is possible that you only understand 40% of what it means to catalog and classify data, but you will understand how the data journeys in your ecosystem. How do you collect it? How does it flow through the Kafka pipeline? How does it get stored into the warehouses? How does it get onboarded across the board into third-party vendors, etc.? How do you measure privacy risk? It'll give you a fuller view of why privacy is hard. It will give engineers an understanding of how they should be building services so that onboarding privacy onto their services downstream becomes easier. It will give the CEOs and CSOs and CPOs and CISOs a much better exposure of how to staff their teams, how to invest things correctly. It will also give people an understanding of how to build privacy tools. So there are people like OneTrust, Big ID, people who build privacy tools. It'll give them an understanding of what the pain points in the industry are. So yes, I've written this book, Privacy by Design, primarily for small businesses and medium-sized businesses. But I feel like if your livelihood has anything to do with data, I think this is a great book for you because it will help you make decisions on what to do and what not to do from privacy perspective, engineering-wise.
Is there a value for consumers as well, just to understand how companies deal with their data?
Absolutely. I feel like customers will really understand what happens to their data. Like my mom and my dad often tell me, my mom, especially because she's very, very tech savvy, she's like, I don't know what data gets collected. I don't know what this company is going to do with my data. Like when I used to work for Google, she routinely asked me, how does Google make money? So whether you are extremely smart and savvy like my mom or you're like my dad who doesn't really care, I think it's going to be a great book for you to understand how the world has changed, how a very simple linear way of building tools has become so data driven, the choices that companies make, the decisions that they have to make, and how you as a customer can make life easier for yourself by making smart decisions at the front end.
Awesome. So we know that as of the time of this recording, the book is not available to the public yet, mm-hmm. but we'll make sure to, I think the publisher is giving an opportunity for people to get it electronically at a price, but we'll also link to it on Amazon once it's available.
Definitely. And if I may make one last push, Chris, if people want to find me on LinkedIn, I'm always looking for smart engineers who work in security and privacy to help build some of these tools I've been talking about. So if you are somebody in this space who's looking for an opportunity or who wants to network, please connect with me. I'm always happy to add to the conversation and learn more from people as well.
And we'll definitely link to your LinkedIn in the notes as well so people can find you. And Nishant, thank you so much for spending some time with us today.
And thank you, Chris, for having me.
You're very welcome. Thank you for listening to this episode of the Easy Prey podcast. If you found this episode educational, please leave a review at easyprey.com/review. Notes and a transcript of this episode with Nishant Bhajaria can be found at easyprey.com/51.